Excellencies, colleagues, let us start our session. I declare open the 8th meeting of the annual session 2016 of the Executive Board of UNDP, UNFPA, and UNOPS. Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, we will continue the UNDP segment with Agenda Item 8, United Nations Capital Development Fund Integrated Annual Report on Results of 2015 and the Midterm Review of the Strategic Framework 2014-2017. I'd like now to give the floor to His Excellency Mr. Degenye Work Get to UNDP Associate Administrator to deliver his introductory remarks, please.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Executive Board. I'm pleased to welcome you to the UNCDF item of the Executive Board, which will focus on UNCDF's 2015 program and operational results, the midterm review of its 2014-2017 strategic framework, and perspectives for the future. Before giving the floor to Ms. Judith Karl, UNCDF Executive Secretary, allow me to make a few remarks. UNCDF and UNDP are fully committed to supporting less developed countries in achieving their graduation and development goals. We have important complementaries to do. We share a strong commitment to ensuring that development processes, resource allocations, and opportunities shift in favor of the so-called last mile. That means the people, localities, and all small enterprises that are underserved or excluded, and where development needs are greatest but resources most scarce. We have strong synergies at country level to maximize. Before LDC's partners, we engage in numerous joint programs, and we are increasingly active in learning and innovating together in the context of the 2030 Development Agenda and blended financial approach. UNCDF brings a unique value proposition to less developed countries and to the international development arena. With its capital mandate, UNCDF helps LDCs to test and scale innovative financial solutions that use public resources, such as ODA, to de-risk, blend, and leverage public and private resources, especially and domestic resources, to reach the last mile. I believe this brings particular depth to the UNCDF-UNDP value proposition in the context of the Addis Ababa Development Agenda, Action Agenda, and the Sustainable Development Goals and the Paris Agreement on Climatic Change by providing specialized incubation and innovation space to the wider work of the UN system. Every one US dollar UNCDF invests results in $10 of investment finance, offering strong leverage and demonstration effect. It also speaks to the significant potential for creating growth and investment opportunities at local level where they benefit poor people most directly. The report you have in front of you illustrates the practical and innovative approach of UNCDF in taking to make finance work for poor people through its work on local development finance and financial inclusion. This work touches on some of the significant development challenges we are facing today. Some examples of UNCDF works are, one, using blended finance to address long-neglected local infrastructure needs. Two, using subnational government capacities to channel global climatic adaptation finance to cope with increased cost-building resilience at local level. Three, by incentivizing financial service providers to reach under and unbanked men and women, including through digital means, UNCDF is showing that the poor are a viable market, have assets, and can contribute to the formation of productive capital in the local space while building household resilience. Four, by connecting women and youth to saving and other financial products, UNCDF is empowering women economically and giving youth financial stake in their local economies and home communities. Five, by innovating with financial intermediaries approach, UNCDF is helping ensure that technological breakthrough like renewable energy resources are reaching poor households and communities. Thanks to the realignment process last year, UNCDF is in a stronger position to continue delivering excellent results during the remainder of the strategic framework period. Clearly, through UNCDF's ability to deliver those results at scale and robustly in the maximum number of LDCs will depend heavily on the health of its funding base, particularly the core funding. We remain concerned with the shortfall in core resources against a very modest ask of $25 million per year to be present in 40 less developed countries. This amounts to an average of $500,000 per country, which is extremely efficient. I would like to thank those member states who are the champions of and contribute to UNCDF's core. Your multi-year commitment to take risk with UNCDF around last-mile finance continues to keep UNCDF on the frontier of innovation in this space and produce the shared learning we all need to be smarter development professionals. I also would like to thank all of you who provided non-core funding to UNCDF's work. We would like to launch the Last Mile Financial Trust Fund, which will be an important contributor to ensuring that UNCDF can meet its commitment to thematic and country program in higher demand from LDCs. Looking ahead, UNCDF faces a wide range of opportunity as it seeks to optimize its capital mandate in world expanding financial innovation and change. UNCDF provides an excellent platform to try out the full range of available funding instruments in LDCs. We will be looking for your support in the coming month to broaden UNCDF's financial toolkit so it can not just scale up its existing instrument and risk-based approach through a careful consider of possible block grants, loan and guarantees, but also carefully consideration of the possibility of working to build blended finance solution with concessional finance, bonds, and other vehicles with the LDCs. This will require, among other things, exploring the possibility for UNCDF to develop a borrowing capacity. Taken together, this will position UNCDF to bring new approach to less developed countries where demanded there. UNCDF is an important contributor to transformation in less developed countries. It is achieving results that substantially leverage its small size and resource base. I encourage member states to provide your full support to UNCDF as it looks to optimize its capital mandate and help LDCs achieve their development goals. I thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kato, for your introductory statement. May I now give the floor to Ms. Judith Karl, Executive Secretary, UNDCF, to present the report, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, distinguished members of the Executive Board, and thank you also, Mr. Associate Administrator of UNDP, for your introductory remarks. And as you mentioned, the strong synergies at the country and headquarters levels between UNDP and UNCDF are designed to bring maximum benefit to our country partners. If fully implemented, the commitments of the Addis Ababa Action Agenda, the 2030 Agenda, the Paris Agreement, and the Istanbul Program of Action Midterm Review together present a once-in-a-lifetime chance to transform the LDCs. UNCDF's work has proved to be highly relevant to this development landscape, with its focus on supporting LDCs to apply a range of finance models in the last mile. The emphasis on leaving no one behind compels us to focus on the approaches needed to support localities, households, and small businesses which are underserved and where resources are most scarce. The roles of subnational finance and financial inclusion are well recognized in all these agendas as critical accelerators of local growth, empowerment, participation, and local resilience. Building on our contributions to the Addis Ababa Action Agenda, the 2030 Agenda, and Paris Agreement in 2015, UNCDF also took part in the World Humanitarian Summit, where we arranged an important dialogue on the promise that digital financial tools, such as mobile phone-based money transfers, hold to improve the delivery of financial assistance during humanitarian crises. This builds on the lessons UNCDF, the Better Than Cash Alliance, and UNDP learned in the application of digital payments during the Ebola response in West Africa, with growing recognition that cash payments should become a higher proportion of overall humanitarian assistance because they can be an important accelerator of early recovery. We believe that the digital payments agenda in crisis situations has a very important future. Immediately after that, UNCDF was in Antalya for the midterm review of the Istanbul Program of Action. Congratulations to all organizing and participating partners for that event, which saw renewed commitments from LDCs, development partners, and UN agencies to support LDC graduation. UNCDF collaborated with a number of government and private sector partners to present case studies and lessons on bringing last-mile finance innovations to LDCs and discussed how we see these models supporting LDC graduation ambitions. These included lessons on how financial intermediation can give poor households, businesses, and localities access to adapted technologies, how innovations in financial inclusion are supporting inclusion, household resilience, and women's economic empowerment, and how ODA can be leveraged to de-risk the subnational economic space and crowd in domestic and international resources. Together with UNDP, we also presented a last-mile action agenda based on research and six case studies with actions that prioritize subnational finance, financial inclusion, and participation in order to tackle exclusions and inequalities in the context of achieving the SDGs. Our integrated annual report on results for 2015 and midterm review of the strategic framework captures the results these approaches continue to deliver. We have achieved overall positive programmatic and institutional results over the first 2 years of the strategic framework, as measured against our integrated results and resources matrix. Over 75% of program outcomes and outputs are on track, with one falling behind and others either not in demand or not yet measurable at the midterm point. Many of you were also involved in our partner perception survey. 70% of respondents strongly agree or agree that UNCDF is achieving intended results against our strategic framework. 86% of partners strongly agree or agree that UNCDF contributes to global and national policy. Behind these headline stories is an important story of how we have been innovating, leveraging resources, empowering women, and in the process, changing investor behavior. Looking back 3 years to the baseline year of the strategic framework, the strategic investments made then with core resources have become flagship programs today that provide critical lessons on innovative finance. First, in the area of financial inclusion. Financial inclusion is a target under 7 of the SDGs, an important enabler for sustainable development. Nevertheless, around 2 billion adults, over half of them women, remain financially excluded. Through our global, regional, and country-level work, We are extending the reach of formal financial services and helping poor people manage their financial lives better. MicroLead is one such flagship. With an initial core contribution of $5 million back in 2009, UNCDF mobilized $20 million more to launch the program. UNCDF invested the funds in financial service providers from the South that brought $100 million of their own equity to expand in 13 least developed countries. After 5 years, they have reached over 1 million depositors, mobilizing savings balances of $450 million. The MicroLead expansion program, which started in 2011, challenges formal financial service providers to reach out to rural populations, particularly women. By deploying alternative delivery channels, the program makes the business case to serve populations previously considered unbankable. This was confirmed in a recent midterm evaluation, which we discussed at our informal with you on the 19th of May. It concluded that the program has the potential to make significant contributions in countries where exclusion is high and financial depth is low. MicroLead expansion is on track to reach an additional 1.3 million clients in 11 countries and mobilize an additional $190 million in deposits. In its next phase, it is seeking to reach 2 million customers across 10 countries. Our investments are yielding important innovations as we pilot new products in new markets. This includes responding to the challenges and opportunities associated with youth employment and digital solutions. Between 2010 and 2015, UNCDF secured a contribution of $11 million for a youth finance pilot in 8 African LDCs. Youth Start more than tripled the pilot's original target, providing over 600,000 youth with access to financial and non-financial services. They saved over $16 million, and over 80,000 young entrepreneurs were provided with $11 million in loans. The program's final evaluation, also presented in our discussions with you last month, found that almost 80% of the youth sampled reported that Youth Start positively influenced their lives. Based on the evaluation's recommendations, UNCDF will, with sufficient funding, deepen the program's integration with vocational training and employment opportunities, and expand the program to more LDCs. Youth Start Global's objectives include reaching 800,000 youth in this next phase. Feedback from youth participants indicates that savings programs gives youth a strong stake in their local economies and motivates them to pursue productive engagement in those economies as they transition from school to employment. We believe such financial inclusion programs have great potential to provide hope and productive opportunities to youth in fragile settings. Building on lessons learned from our Pacific Financial Inclusion Program, UNCDF launched Mobile Money for the Poor to enable the adoption of digital financial services at scale. UNCDF core resources of $1 million combined with $860,000 in cost sharing launched the program in 4 countries. Based on this pilot, the program was able to attract an additional $6 million for work in Uganda, an additional $26 million for expansion to Benin, Senegal, and Zambia. This helped raise funds for our work in Laos, PDR, and Nepal. The goal is to see at least 15% of adults, that's considered a tipping point in financial inclusion work, 15% of adults using digital financial services in the 8 markets where it operates. This equates to 10 million people. UNCDF hosts the Better Than Cash Alliance, which supports governments, companies, and international organizations to accelerate the transition from cash to digital payments. This alliance has grown rapidly to 50 members in its first few years, signaling the growing recognition of the benefits to transparency, efficiency, and access that digitizing payments can bring. UNCDF has also been testing financial intermediation as a route to clean energy access. Clean Start was launched late in 2012 in Nepal and has since grown to cover Cambodia, Ethiopia, Myanmar, and Uganda. By the end of 2015, it was reaching some 50,000 clients. Now, Clean Start is raising funds to launch at least 5 new energy access challenge rounds that could lead to as many as 300,000 clients through at least 25 new partners, most of them using digital payment platforms. This is expected to benefit up to 1.5 million people. We are also seeing results through data-driven, and market ecosystems approaches that reveal opportunities to public and private sector investors. Our Making Access Possible program adopts a robust diagnostic approach that helps governments and national stakeholders develop financial inclusion strategies and roadmaps. Early evidence indicates that demand-side data and road mapping can incentivize private sector investment in financial inclusion, particularly by revealing the potential of untapped markets in the last mile. Between 2012 and 2015, the program grew from the initial four-country pilot to 16 countries across Asia and Africa. Making Access Possible is also becoming a useful engine for South-South learning and has already produced a valuable publication series that is available on our website. Now I would like to turn to our second practice area, local development finance. Achieving structural transformation and the SDGs requires much greater empowerment of local authorities and the investment of domestic public and private finance in local economies. Without this transformation, LDCs may continue to grow, but miss the opportunity to bridge the gap to a sustainable and equitable growth path. This has been called the LDC trap, and our work in this space is dedicated to broadening and deepening transformative change through more effective public and private investment at the local level. Resource flows and transparent implementation platforms for infrastructure, food security, renewable energy, climate change, and women's economic empowerment at the local level have proven acceleration effects for poverty reduction and local economic development. Rural and urban local governments play a fundamental role in this process, as newly recognized by the Paris Agreement and the new urban agenda that is expected to emerge from Habitat 3 in Quito. This agenda foresees a fresh partnership between subnational and central government to achieve the SDGs. This is built on recognition of mutual strengths. The imperative is because continuing population growth and urbanization are projected to add 2.5 billion people to the world's urban population by 2050, with nearly 90% of the increase concentrated in Asia and Africa. In response, UNCDF deploys a growing range of financial tools and instruments to unlock investments in local infrastructure and services. One way UNCDF does this is through innovations in fiscal decentralization that build local capacities, strengthen accountability, and boost financial management. We have seen this expand the financial bandwidth of local governments to make and manage investments in infrastructure and services, as has been the case, for instance, in Niger. A striking example is UNCDF's supported reform in Guinea that ensures a proportion of royalties from extractive industry is reinvested into local economies through local governments using UNCDF's Local Development Fund and Local Finance Initiative methods. Furthermore, municipalities can face difficulties in attracting the investments they need to provide people with opportunities and decent living standards. We are diversifying the sources of their financing by tapping into loans, public-private partnerships, and bonds, and carving out innovation space for sources such as crowdfunding. We do this as a full member of the Cities Alliance and in full collaboration with the United Cities and Local Governments, or UCLG, as part of our contribution to the Global Task Force for Localizing the SDGs. The municipal finance work has begun in Senegal, Tanzania, Uganda, and Bangladesh. Structured project finance is proving to be another impactful way of empowering local authorities and filling their financing gap. UNCDF's Local Finance Initiative, which we began in 2012, set out to show that prioritized local infrastructure projects can attract domestic funding. By directing ODA to de-risk these investments, this initiative has demonstrated that domestic, private, and international finance can be leveraged at a rate of at least 1 to 10. In Tanzania, $1.2 million in seed capital spent through this program has so far unlocked $52 million from the domestic private sector, and this number is growing. The program is now emerging as a national platform for investable projects across Tanzania. In Bangladesh, Benin, Lao PDR, Senegal, and Uganda, it is in various stages of operationalization. We also deploy our toolkit to tackle vulnerabilities. To this end, We promote financing mechanisms and institutions that provide sustainable resources for local climate resilience and improve food security. Since its launch in 2011 in Bhutan and Cambodia, our local climate adaptive living facility, or LOCAL, has expanded to 11 countries with grants transferred to 10 of them. With an investment of $1 million in core resources, UNCDF tested and proved the innovation. It has since leveraged more than $18 million in non-core. Over the last 2 years, dozens of local authorities have been capacitated to manage performance-based climate-resilient grants representing a population of some 10 million people. In Bhutan, 47 infrastructure projects have been implemented, including the construction of fortified roads and elevated bridges. The demonstration effect encouraged the European Union to take the LOCAL mechanism to scale through budget support. Last year, the LOCAL Program Board, comprising the 11 participating governments, agreed that LOCAL should become a recognized mechanism for local governments to directly access the Green Climate Fund. Cambodia began that process last year. Other LDCs have expressed interest in joining the program. Because UNCDF has traditionally operated in rural areas, food security has become an essential element in our approach over time. The Finance for Food program supports planning, budgeting, and monitoring tools to strengthen local food systems and link rural productive areas to urban markets. It was launched in 2015 to act as a global umbrella program for UNCDF's local development programs working on food security. It now includes already existing programs in Niger, Mali, Benin, Burundi, and Mozambique that have mobilized nearly $25 million in non-core resources since 2009. Over the same period, UNCDF core spending on the same programs amounted to $6.5 million, the bulk of which was for programs in Mali and Niger. The overall result of these efforts is a portfolio of programs that is successfully reinvesting resources locally to reduce inequalities and to build resilience and improve lives and livelihoods at the grassroots level. All of these initiatives also promote gender equality, as do those in our growing portfolio of programs specifically empowering women. Our inclusive and equitable local development program seeks to help governments and the private sector at the local level design, plan, implement, and sustain local public and private investments for women's economic empowerment and entrepreneurship. It is a joint UNCDF, UNDP, and UN Women initiative. The average size of a project will be in the range of $5 million, and our typical average grants will range from $100,000 to $200,000. As such, the leverage that the grants can unlock for each project will be between 1 to 25 and 1 to 50. This has begun in Bangladesh and Tanzania. Our Shaping Inclusive Finance Transformations, SHIFT, seeks to accelerate financial inclusion and women's economic participation in the ASEAN region. The program started in mid-2014 with a core commitment of $500,000 to initiate work in Cambodia, Lao PDR, Myanmar, and Vietnam, and to support policy processes at the ASEAN level. Since then, a further $13 million has been leveraged in non-core and parallel funding for interventions in ASEAN and adaptation into the SAARC region, starting with Bangladesh. The program has completed 5 deals aimed at reaching 75,000 women through crowding in $1.6 million in new private sector investments. A further 19 deals have been identified, which, if the full project co-financing from UNCDF were available, would reach over 2 million women through over 8.5 million in new private sector co-financing investments. For each of these programs to move from innovation to scale, they needed a careful mix of the following: the initial core resource investment to innovate the model, learn lessons for replication, and create the conditions for leveraging additional resources; the right staff to manage partnerships and provide technical expertise; the seed capital to conduct feasibility studies and incentivize investor behavior; and patience to shift the dynamics of how finance flows. Now these programs are poised to scale up and replicate successes in more LDCs. There are also a number of exciting new frontiers that are ripe for innovation if the resources are available. These include using financial intermediation to bring adapted technologies to the last mile, expanding the reach of microinsurance, particularly in the face of natural disasters, making it easier and cheaper to send and receive payments and remittances, and using remittances as a way to drive greater productive engagement in local economies, using innovative finance to support secondary cities to meet the demands of the new urban agenda, using geo-satellite data to help LDCs to prioritize their local climate adaptation investments, using digital technologies to improve crisis response, and making concessional finance work for LDCs at the subnational level. Those are just a few of the new frontiers where UNCDF would like to be working in the next stage of the strategic framework. Now, let me very briefly turn to the institutional effectiveness front, where we continue to improve how we operate. 85% of institutional effectiveness outputs were on track or above track. UNCDF is more fit for purpose today than it was a year ago. We concluded an organizational realignment process that led to a streamlined staffing structure, new efficiency measures, and savings of approximately 20% of staff costs against our core resources. Total expenditure in 2015 was $70 million, $8.2 million higher than in 2014. This underscores our focus on effective program delivery against available resources. We were also able to preserve the minimum 40% capital component in our expenditure profile. In 2015, the capital component against total program resources stood at 46%. We have finalized our enterprise risk management policy and will continue to strengthen our capacity to identify, monitor, and mitigate risks associated with our capital investment mandate in close cooperation with UNDP. We will also continue embedding greater transparency as a core operating principle for the organization. Staff provide the backbone of our knowledge-intensive organization, and we seek high employee engagement. We also seek gender parity in the workforce. We have achieved an overall increase in female staff to 49%, up from 27% in 2013. This is excellent progress, but we still have work to do to reach parity in the P5 and higher categories. At the same time, our potential to innovate and bring pilots to scale is constrained by the worrying reduction in our core resource envelope. It has dropped from $16 million in 2013 to $11.6 million in 2015, in 2 years. It is projected to come in under $10 million this year, based on currently confirmed pledges. That is only 40% of the $25 million annual target needed for the presence in 40 LDCs. So allow me now to thank all those donors who provide us with our core resources, who champion our work, and who support innovation and risk-taking through their contributions to the core. In 2016, those who have confirmed contributions include Sweden and Switzerland, our champions for the core, Luxembourg, Australia, Norway, the United States, Austria, Myanmar, Laos PDR, and Thailand. We recognize donors like Switzerland that provide multi-year funding, and welcome that Australia joined as a core donor for the first time last year and increased its contribution this year, as did Sweden. We also recognize Sweden for the role they are playing to champion the Last Mile Finance Trust Fund that we just launched over lunch today. We urge other member states to follow suit. We are also grateful to our many and diversified non-core donors, too numerous to name them all here, but many of whom are in this room. And we thank you for your readiness to pilot, replicate, and scale up with us. As we travel along the maturity journey of innovation to scale together, we are generating critical momentum and learning that we know can help accelerate LDC progress towards graduation. Core resources ensure our strategic engagement at country level. The projectization of our country footprint, highlighted as a concern by partners in our perception survey, is a direct result of reduced core. Just as the core investments of 3 years ago seeded our current flagships, so we need a strong core today to seed tomorrow's flagships. Because of the downturn in the core, 2016 is at risk of being the first year when we will fall short of the 40% capital target against total program resources, and the first year when the proportion of resources invested in innovation falls below the critical amount required to pilot new approaches that could become the flagships of tomorrow. Also, as the core resource base shrinks, the only way to ensure that we preserve the innovation to scale continuum in each of our programs is to reduce the number of countries where we implement those programs. In order to maximize the incentive to partners to engage with CDF's business model, we have reinforced our four-window funding architecture. As window one, the core remains the bedrock of our country presence, innovation, and risk capacity. The other three windows provide a continuum of options from lightly earmarked to special purpose, through which we aim to strengthen partnerships across the spectrum of public, foundation, and private sources. Taken together, they provide a compelling mix of flexible and directed finance that will help expand UNCDF's financial toolbox under the new development agenda. As innovators and incubators of those models that make financial work for the poor, that make finance work for the poor, we must ensure that LDCs are well placed to benefit from shifts in development finance. We've revised our loan policy and aim to increase our use of loans. This is linked to our efforts, as the Associate Administrator mentioned, to seek the authority to borrow from the growing number of concessional windows so we can demonstrate how LDCs can make best use of these concessional windows in the last mile. And we will be coming back to you in the coming months on this vehicle. As we enter the second half of the strategic framework period, we are also beginning our reflection on our next strategic framework, and I look forward to our exchanges in the coming year as we embark on that new path together. Thank you all.
I thank Ms. Khan for the presentation on the integrated annual report and the midterm review of the strategic framework for 2014 and 2017. I will now open the floor for comments and questions. Colleagues, you have heard the presentation of the report by Ms. Judith Karl, so now you have the opportunity to have comments, to have questions. So in my list, I have Australia, Switzerland, Nepal, China. And for those who have not requested for the floor, they can do so by using the electronic system to request for the floor if you wish to. I now give the floor to Australia.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Mr. Associate Administrator of UNDP, for your introductory remarks. I wish to congratulate the Executive Secretary, Judith Karl, for her report on results achieved in 2015. Australia welcomes the work done by all agencies on their midterm reviews, and we congratulate UNCDF on the very positive results it has achieved against almost all key performance benchmarks. UNCDF's report demonstrates tangible contributions to the global development agenda based on a clearly articulated theory of change for the organisation. We note with appreciation the changes proposed to the integrated results and resources framework as a result of the midterm review findings, particularly those which strengthen UNCDF's ability to report on gender outcomes. It is essential that all agencies meet their system-wide action plan on gender equality and the empowerment of women reporting requirements. And we are pleased to see that reporting of sex disaggregated data will be strengthened in the revised framework. We urge UNCDF to continue to expand its efforts in this space. With the midterm review now complete, we encourage UNCDF to build on these outcomes to inform the next UNCDF strategic plan. UNCDF is well placed to deliver on the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. Connecting public, private, and domestic resources to achieve development outcomes will be critical to delivering on the Addis Ababa Action Agenda, and this is an area where UNCDF has proven expertise. We also commend UNCDF on its innovation approach, which pilots, tests, and scales new solutions to key development challenges. Australia is committed to innovation, and as such is very pleased to be a core contributor to UNCDF this year so they can continue to innovate and test new development solutions. The niche role UNCDF plays in testing new approaches and instruments and working to scale them up through partners, including governments and development banks, is critical to accelerating progress towards the SDGs. We would particularly like to emphasise the important role UNCDF plays in bringing innovative financial products to the Pacific through the Pacific Financial Inclusion Program. This program is increasing access to financial services among low-income and rural households in Samoa, Tonga and Vanuatu and other Pacific countries. It designs financial literacy programs, builds the skills and capability of financial service providers, and provides performance-based grants to financial service providers to develop and implement pro-poor financial services. PFIP is also testing new approaches and working with new partners, including the innovative money transfer operator ClickX to lower the cost of remittances. It's also working with the bank ANZ to support the rollout of the GoMoney mobile banking platform in Solomon Islands. Finally, UNCDF can make a substantial contribution to women's economic empowerment and gender equality, and we see potential to scale up these efforts. The SHIFT program, for example, aims to improve the level of financial inclusion in the ASEAN region, particularly for women as employees, customers and entrepreneurs. The Australian Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade's partnership with UNCDF was pivotal in the SHIFT program becoming gender-focused. UNCDF's focus on women is very positive. However, we would encourage UNCDF to bring a stronger gender lens to all aspects of its work. One example could be to ensure that global knowledge products such as Making Access Possible, or MAP, the financial inclusion survey applied at the country level, includes analyses of gender data as a core component, and that gender is resourced in staff support both from head office and project specific. Gender equality may be a standalone goal of the 2030 agenda, but it is also fundamental to the delivery of development outcomes across the global development agenda. Recognising the role of women in the local economy as consumers, household managers, employers and entrepreneurs, and finding ways to overcome barriers to their participation is absolutely essential. We look forward to continuing to work with UNCDF to build innovative approaches to women's economic empowerment. Thank you.
Thank you, the distinguished representative of Australia, for her comments. May I now give the floor to the distinguished representative of Switzerland. You have the floor, please.
Mr. Chair, thank you. I'm pleased to deliver this statement on behalf of the United States, Sweden, and my own country, Switzerland. We wish to thank the Executive Secretary, Judith Karl, and her team for UNCDF's excellent performance as presented in the report on results achieved by UNCDF in 2015, as well as the midterm review of the Strategic Framework 2014-17. Mr. Chair, a bit less than a year ago, Member States negotiated the Addis Ababa Action Agenda on how to finance the SDGs. The Addis Ababa Action Agenda is the blueprint for financing the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals and sets the frame on how to maximize development finance. For us, there are three key elements to the Addis Ababa Action Agenda. First, domestic resources are the main resources to finance sustainable development. Second, we need to attract private finance and business activities towards sectors and countries where the impact on the SDGs is biggest. And third, ODA remains important for sustainable development, especially in the poorest and most fragile countries. These three main tenets of the Addis Ababa Action Agenda are all prominent features of UNCDF's mission and programming. As the only UN agency with a focus entirely on LDCs, UNCDF is working in places where other sources of external finance are not available. By strengthening local government actors, especially at the subnational level, to set up productive and conducive framework conditions for private sector activities, UNCDF supports its partner countries to generate the resources, both financial and in terms of capacity building needed to work towards the SDGs. And by leveraging private finance, both in its local development finance and financial inclusion work, UNCDF can have a much larger impact than by using public finance alone. The results of UNCDF's is achieving in both practice areas are encouraging. The midterm review shows significant progress towards the strategic goals established in 2014, albeit in a smaller number of LDCs than initially planned. Furthermore, evaluation results in many program areas show that UNCDF's programming is relevant and provides great value to its stakeholders. We look forward to have more information at the impact level of UNCDF work in the future, which is more difficult to measure and evaluate, but could be part of future evaluation efforts. Mr. Chair, UNCDF falls, however, short in one key area. The continued decrease of core funding is worrying and puts into jeopardy the achievement of the results by 2017. Potentially further reducing the number of LDCs UNCDF is working in is not an encouraging prospect and would undermine UNCDF's mandate. As we embark on the implementation of the 2030 agenda, we believe that UNCDF is already quite fit for purpose. However, it is not clear whether its current budget levels are suitable for UNCDF to implement its programs. We therefore urge the Executive Secretary to pursue the resource mobilization strategy presented last year at full throttle. The streamlined funding windows and especially the last mile trust fund are certainly a step in the right direction. We encourage UNCDF to pursue all available options to secure reliable, unearmarked funding to support its work in LDCs. These options could include expanding its activities in frontier finance, making better use of loans and risk guarantees and other instruments to leverage private and other resources, building partnerships with multiple stakeholders and pursuing additional investment opportunities that would allow the agency to capitalize on its unique mandate and positioning to best enable scale up and expand its critical work. We also believe that UNCDF will need to come up with a strategy on how it can remain an effective and relevant organization even if it falls short of the envisaged $25 million a year of core base, as this seems a rather big leap from where we are today. This is something to be addressed in the next strategic framework. The countries supporting this statement are all doing their share, and I would like to make some remarks that talk to the specific support provided by the signatories of this statement. The United States is doing its part to support UNCDF financially. US doubled core contribution from $500,000 to $900,000 between 2013 and 2015. And for the upcoming fiscal year, have increased the request for UNCDF core funding to $5 million US. While it is uncertain if the US Congress will grant this request, the scale of the increase shows the seriousness of the United States' commitment to this excellent agency. The U.S. is also actively exploring partnership between UNCDF and various agencies and initiatives within the U.S. government and in the private sector. Sweden has for many years been one of the main contributors to UNCDF regular resources, contributing more than $120 million in core resources since 1992. This year, Sweden increased its core contribution to more than $3 million, a sign of the appreciation Sweden has for UNCDF's business model and the results delivered to date. Sweden also provides support to UNCDF programs between 2010 and 2017. Sweden will have to be to have contributed over $31 million to UNCDF in non-core resources. My own country, Switzerland, is a keen supporter of UNCDF and has been amongst the three largest country core contributors for 3 years now. We believe that in order to fulfill its mandate, it is crucial that UNCDF is provided with the necessary resources to keep their foot on the ground in LDCs and to provide the technical backstopping that is key to its specialized vision and mandate. For Switzerland, the core value of working with UNCDF is the fact that it has been working in particular LDCs for decades, all the while preserving its capacity to innovate and adapt to changing circumstances. We have often found partnering with UNCDF at the local level to add great value to our own development work in the areas of inclusive finance and local economic development. Without a strong foundation with Europa's core funding base, UNCDF will not be able to be that partner we all value and rely on. All the countries that join this statement encourage countries in a position to do so to consider a possible support to UNCDF's core resources. With a relatively modest core contribution compared to that of other organizations, member states could ensure that UNCDF can complete the 2014 to 2017 strategy and deliver its crucial services in all 48 LDCs. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. I thank the distinguished representative of Switzerland for his comments and, of course, the contributions to the budget of the UNDCF. It's very important. May I now give the floor to the distinguished representative of Nepal? You have the floor.
Mr. Chair, I thank you very much for giving me the floor. At the outset, I wish to express my sincere thanks to the Associate Administrator for his introductory remarks. I would also like to take this opportunity to appreciate Ms. Judith Karl, Executive Secretary of UNCDF, for the comprehensive presentation of the report on the results achieved by the United Nations Capital Development Fund in 2015. Nepal congratulates UNCDF for the progress achieved over the first 2 years of implementation of the UNCDF strategic framework and its further commitment to do even better in the remaining years. As UNCDF activities are aimed at reducing extreme poverty and hunger and promoting gender equality through enhanced access to microfinance and strengthen local development capacity, the fund has a particular focus with priority on the LDCs. It is evident that UNCDF programs have a clear pro-poor focus, inclusive finance approach, and local-level capacity building orientation. It is for this reason that Nepal, like other LDCs, and one of the beneficiaries of its programs, highly values the fund's activities. We note with appreciation that UNCDF had made significant contributions towards the achievement of MDGs and LDCs. As we are gearing up for the implementation of Agenda 2030 for the Sustainable Development Goal, the UNCDF shall also be fit for the purpose in order to support LDCs in achieving the new agenda. The recent activities of UNCDF are the true manifestation of its efforts towards that direction. It is our expectation that the fund should further redouble its effort to ensure increased efficiency and delivery of results in its areas of mandate. We emphasize that UNCDF should also give utmost priority to increasing coverage and impact of its inclusive finance and local development programs to all LDCs, not just confined to 31 LDCs currently, in order to realize the goal of leave no one behind. Mr. Chair, in Nepal, UNCDF has been promoting financial inclusion since 2008 and is currently applying its financial inclusion models to areas of relevance to the national development agenda. The Access to Finance Initiative, Clean Energy Access, Digital Finance through the Mobile Money for the Poor Program, Local Governance and Community Development Program, Climate Change Adaptation Programs are the some programs through which UNCDF has been complementing our endeavor to eradicate poverty and ensuring financial inclusiveness, among others. The Istanbul Program of Action for the LDCs aims to enable half of the LDCs to meet graduation criteria by 2020. The progress so far does not provide promising results to that end. We all know that addressing poverty and building human capacities remain at the core of such graduation criteria. Therefore, UNCDF operational activities in LDCs will have to contribute towards smooth and sustainable graduation of LDCs so that LDCs, once graduated, sustain their progress forever. Nepal has also announced our ambition to be graduated by 2022. But our ambition was shattered by the massive earthquake that struck Nepal in April-May 2015 last year, which added more than 700,000 people under the extreme poverty. At this situation, we need enhanced international, technical, and financial support in a predictable manner to sustain our effort in the days to come. We express serious concerns over the reduction in core funding for UNCDF at a time when the countries in special situations, such as the LDCs and LLDCs, and countries emerging from conflict, need scaling up and expanding its programs in light of the implementation of comprehensive development agenda, including the SDGs. Therefore, we think this must be reversed. We underline that UNCDF future efforts should be geared towards increasing the effectiveness of its support to LDCs by developing new products, building new strategic partnerships, and continuing to improve its performance while taking into account the critical need for achieving SDGs and other internationally agreed development goals by the LDCs. Nepal is particularly pleased to hear that, looking forward, UNCDF will be adapting its models to new frontiers of financing response to emerging challenges related to youth, expanding digital financial space and micro insurance, using financial intermediation to unlock access to adapted technologies for poor customers, and applying new financial solutions to address infrastructure and climate vulnerability problems in rural and semi-urban areas. I thank you, Mr. Chair.
I thank the distinguished representative of Nepal for his statement. May I now give the floor to the distinguished representative of China to take the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to thank Associate Administrator for his introduction. I'd also like to thank Executive Secretary and Judith Karl for her statement. China appreciates the efforts made by UNCDF in building channels, mechanisms, and a policy environment of financing for the LDCs, as well as the fund's various achievements in 2015. We are concerned at the decline of the fund's core resources and hope it will take measures to improve its capital ratio so as to better serve the LDCs in their endeavor to realize sustainable development. Thank you.
Thank you. the distinguished representative of China for her statement. I have exhausted my list, but if delegations wish to take the floor, I think we... Yeah, I think if no more further requests for the floor, I would now turn to our colleagues at the panel to respond to the comments and questions by the delegations, if any one of us would like to.
Yes,
Ms. Khan.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Thank you to the distinguished members of the board for the comments. It's, I'm very pleased to hear the calls for focus on the funding situation for the organization, and I can certainly assure all member states that we are deploying all efforts possible to look at the opportunities for improving the financial situation of the organization, including looking at a range of new partnerships, but also looking at how new partnerships and new financial instruments themselves can come together in the form of new solutions for some of the financing gaps that exist in LDCs, and we think that the two can work well together with the right formulas and the right capacities in UNCDF. And we believe that between now and next year there will be quite a bit of progress in terms of both the financial picture as well as the focus on expanding our financial toolkit. So we count on the support of this body and all the member states to help us along that trajectory. There was a particular question on, or let's say observation on evaluation and a focus on impact evaluation. What I can say is that with a very small evaluation unit, we have, in my view at least, managed to maintain quite a productive review of lessons and formal evaluations, 25 evaluations since 2010. And our aim has been not only to ensure that the evaluations are looking at the direct results coming out of our interventions, but they are also looking at the larger impacts, the transformative impacts that those results are having, both in terms of the policy environments that we're operating in and whether or not we are successfully influencing policy, but also in terms of the longer-term sustainability of the results of those programs, and whether or not increasingly we will be looking at the kinds of impacts that they're having on actually changing behaviors and changing the way finance flows beyond the immediate life of the projects themselves. I think that the two recent evaluations that we discussed in May with the member states, the evaluations on our MicroLEAD and Youth Start programs, both were headed in this direction. In the case of Youth Start, even though the program, the initial pilot of Youth Start, did not intentionally target the policy environment as an explicit result because it was a pilot to see whether we could make the financial models, the unbankability, if we could turn around the perceived unbankability of youth and actually make that a viable business case for financial service providers in the first instance, which we believe that that we were able to do. The recommendations coming out of that evaluation are very much targeted at the implications for the policy environment, but also implications for the larger employment and livelihoods opportunities that those youth will be able to benefit from as a result of having become banked, if you will, as a result of having been able to establish savings accounts and become qualified for loans, what that means in terms of their transition from school to employability. And those types of wider observations and recommendations from the evaluation have been incorporated into the next phase of the program. So we're very strongly committed to looking more and more at impact evaluation and at how that can be applied in our various models. The only other thing I would say on evaluation is that they have tended to be programmatic, and we are also looking at doing more thematic evaluations. Again, that's where funding can become a constraint, because we fund for programmatic evaluations, but doing thematics can be an additionality. So we're also looking at ways of getting some additional partnerships and support for the evaluation process, so that we can also take on more retrospective impact evaluations across different programs that are bound together by a common theme. Thank you to Australia for the comments, and also for the encouragement on the women's economic empowerment and the need to further strengthen the focus on women's economic empowerment and gender parity across our portfolio. We agree very much with that. I wonder, Mr. President, with your permission, whether I might, given that we have a little bit of time, ask my colleagues down on that end, Henri Domel, who's the director of our financial inclusion program and would be able to speak to the specific reference you made to the Making Access Possible program and shift, and then David Jackson, who is the director of our local development finance group, to talk about the innovations that local development finance is introducing on women's economic empowerment in that practice area. So with your permission, Mr. President, if I may.
Yes, thank you, but we have 15 minutes, so please be brief. Thank you.
Yeah, briefly.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Judith. So yes, thank you for the comments. I think it's very useful. I think you frame very well the way that we're looking at women economic empowerment through financial inclusion, looking at the different role of women as entrepreneurs, consumer, employees, head of household. And I think, as you mentioned, we have deployed this diagnostic framework called MAP to kind of help governments inform their financial inclusion strategies. You know, I think what we realize is there is embedded into the kind of survey and questionnaire underlying MAP of enormous wealth of information on a range of socioeconomic factors and kind of issues which help us understand why and how women and men access or don't access financial services. And I think the challenge you raise is a very relevant one, in the sense that we are now working on how to make more explicit the kind of database that MAP offers on a kind of a gender disaggregation analysis, more explicit, so that instead of having to do a deep dive into the data underlying the diagnostic, we kind of have access to it more in a more forthcoming manner as we help governments to shape the financial inclusion strategy. And I think it's, what we realize as well is, as we do that through the diagnostic, a range of our intervention have a very strong focus and impact on women economic empowerment through some of the program that were mentioned by Judith. And we see a lot of really interesting connection. Adolescent GERD, access to savings account, for example, through our U-START program. Our micro lead program targeting mostly women in rural areas and trying to leverage linkage models, informal savings group. So I think, combining MAP, the data, making it more explicit and connecting to the range of other program we have, I think we will be in a stronger place very soon to better leverage that data and analysis we have. So thank you again for your comments.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much indeed. And to complement that, in terms of the local development finance work on women's economic empowerment, we're very happy to inform you that we've recently, together with UNDP and UN Women, approved a global program called Inclusive and Equitable Local Development, that is really about women's economic empowerment in the least developed countries. And it's a joined-up UN initiative. It started in Bangladesh and Tanzania, and it aims to unlock the structural barriers within the local economy that are holding women back. So it's quite a unique approach, and it looks at, and the answers, the solutions are different in different cases. In some cases, it's transport, issues, in some cases it's childcare issues, in some cases security issues, the jobs market, access to water. There are particular structural barriers that hold back women from entering the labour market and from becoming fully economically empowered. And the purpose of this programme is to identify those structural barriers and then seek to mobilise public and private investment for projects and investments that overcome these structural barriers and that can be measured in terms of their impact on women's economic empowerment. So it's the measurable impact that we are working very closely with our colleagues in UN Women and empowerwomen.org. And it's a nice initiative in the sense that you get the UNCDF investment approach. You get UNDP's presence on the ground and their advocacy and their footprint and their long legacy in this area. And you get the specific tools from UN Women and empowerwomen.org that seek to enable us to identify those investments that unblock the barriers to women's economic empowerment and then continue to measure the impact as we go forwards. And one of the things we're quite interested in doing is exploring with you where in the countries of interest, the LDCs of interest for Australia, perhaps in Southeast Asia, you might be interested in looking at this programme, which is quite complementary, if you like, to the approach of SHIFT. So thank you very much indeed.
So I hope that that we have addressed most of the or all of the specific questions and recommendations. I'd just like to thank everyone for the encouragement, for the recognition of the work that went into the revisions of the integrated results and resources framework, which for us is a very critical part of the work that we do, because the only way we know that we're having impact is if we are looking at the we're looking at the leverage, we're looking at the disaggregated indicators, and we're looking over time. So it's also not just the immediacy of the outputs, but it's also whether we're seeing a knock-on effect and a sustainability that's changing the way finance flows and is changing the way local economies are actually structured and producing returns for their citizens. Thank you for the support for the results framework, and we will very much look forward to taking these comments also into the reflection in the coming year on the new strategic framework as that process gets underway. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Ms. Judith Karl, for the response to the comments and questions from delegations. Now we have come to the end of the discussion on item 8 of this segment. So I wish to inform the board that a draft decision is being prepared, and we will revert to item 8 later to adopt a decision. Thank you very much, and thank you for your active participation and constructive engagement. Thank you.
Good afternoon, colleagues. We will continue now the UNDP segment with agenda item 9, United Nations Volunteers, report of the administrator as contained in document DP/2016/15. And to begin, I would like to give the floor to Mr. Getu, UNDP Associate Administrator, to make some introductory remarks. Mr. Getu, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. Mr. President, members of the Executive Board, I'm pleased to introduce a session on the Administrator Report on the United Nations Volunteers for the Biennium 2014-2015, incorporating the midterm review of its 2014-2017 strategic framework. Before giving the floor to Mr. Richard Dictas, I would like to say a few things about the report and the strong relationship between UNDP and UNV. As outlined in the administrator report, UNV is focused on continuing to adapt to be fit for purpose of maximizing volunteer opportunity within the United Nations system and delivering volunteer and volunteerism solutions for the 2030 agenda. In the past few years, UNV has undergone a strategic evolution, which has enabled it's more innovative while being more result-focused than ever before. UNV is a common service to the United Nations system, which worked with nearly 30 UN entities in 2016. In UNDP, we are pleased to emphasize the value of UNV and the value UNV brings to our operations. In 2015, UNDP deployed over 2,100 United Nations volunteers to support UNDP projects and programs. One example of UNDP-UNV partnership was the response to the devastating earthquake in Nepal. In 2015, UNDP mobilized 84 national UN volunteers, civil engineers, and youth volunteers who managed earthquake debris and also demolition of dangerous structures under a joint project with UNDP and Government of Nepal. The UN volunteers also trained 200 community workers in building assessments. The newly trained workers in turn led teams as part of a UNDP cash for work scheme, thus involving thousands of people in safe demolition and recovery. This example highlights the value of UNVs and volunteers to UNDP and UN partners. Community-level presence, the reinforcement of social cohesion through voluntary work, and the reward for volunteerism in local service delivery. UNV is much more than a strategic partner to UNDP. UNDP was entrusted in 1970 by General Assembly to administer UNV. In this relationship, UNV has UNDP's full programmatic, administrative, financial, and legal support to deliver its mandate. UNV is also to leverage the UNDP network at global, regional, and country level. For example, the over 80 UNV field units are embedded within UNDP country offices. UNV also is able to benefit from UNDP's expertise and system for financial performance. As the administrator's report outlined, in the context of a declining core funding environment and then volunteers, numbers not at their midterm target, there is an important need for financial sustainability of UNV. With UNDP support, UNV intends to emerge from a challenging financial cycle and a much leaner and more focused organization with renewed effort to tap into new non-traditional sources of mobilization opportunities. the President. On the personal note, though my time in the UN system and UNDP at the country level, through my time in UN system and UN country level as an NRC and a program person, I have been thoroughly impressed with those individuals who volunteer their time and expertise in UNDP volunteers. I would like to thank the 6,400 UNDP volunteers and the 11,800 UNDP online volunteers carrying out assignments across the world for peace and development, often serving in challenging and more remote locations. I have seen my own eyes this in southern Sudan. For them and for the 300 UNDP personnel, I hope you will join me in noting appreciation for their service to UNDP, the UN system, and the people we serve. I gave the floor to Richard Dictus to present short videos and the administrator's report guideline in detail. Thank you very much.
Quand vous y donné une autre image des Nations Unies, ce n'est pas quelque chose d'abstrait, ce n'est pas que des gens qu'on voit à la télé, mais c'est des gens qui viennent, qui contribuent à faire améliorer les conditions de vie des populations.
The most valuable thing we've got from UNVs is being able to put our international knowledge into a local setting. So we might come with an idea that we've tested out and tried and executed in another part of the world, but we'll be able to understand from the UNVs here how it can be adapted. We can't do half the things we do if we don't have UNVs.
We can really feel the energy that comes with them and the determination and the fast learning curve.
UNV were one of the first organizations who offered any concrete support. It's also been great because UNV is part of the UN family of organizations, and in this project we can feel that this is joining up bits of work that's being done by other agencies within the UN.
The working experience with UN volunteers is an extremely positive one. We are the mission at UNESCO with most volunteers in a peacekeeping mission. We have around 600 UN volunteers in most areas. So one can really say we could not fulfill our mission, we could not fulfill our mandate without UN volunteers.
Thank you, Associate Administrator, for your introduction of the Administrator's report. We at UNV are very grateful for the commitment and support provided by you, the Administrator, and UNDP in general. Madame la Présidente, Excellencies and distinguished members of the Executive Board, with an example of the role and contribution of volunteers and volunteerism to peace and development. In December last year, I visited South Sudan to meet with the government, partners, and the 530 UN volunteers serving there. South Sudan represents a unique combination of UN volunteers supporting UN peacekeeping, as well as UN agency development programs. I was accompanied by representatives from Korea, Japan, the Netherlands, Sweden, and the UN country team on a visit to the teaching hospital in Juba. There, we met with four UN volunteer midwives serving with UNFPA who are saving the lives of women and newborn babies by providing a well-run maternity ward. The facilities, upgraded by UNFPA with support from the governments of Japan and Canada, also enabled a new crop of 100 skilled birth attendants to be trained by those UN volunteers in the last 3 years. We met with the current group, 26 health workers on reproductive health, including 6 traditional birth attendants, an enormous promise for the future of that country. With over 18,000 on-site and online volunteers every year, UNV is facilitating the engagement of men, women, and young people to serve and support the efforts of the United Nations and member states in peacekeeping, humanitarian response, and development programming. As part of a global coalition of volunteer-involving organizations, UNV is reaching out to individuals, communities, and diverse actors in order to contribute to leaving no one behind over the next decade and beyond. Madam President, today, in addition to the Administrator's report before you, I have also the pleasure to launch the UNV Annual Report for 2015, which provides further insights into the results of the organisation. With these reports, we are bringing three main strategic issues to the attention of the Executive Board. First, to highlight the programmatic and institutional results that UNV has delivered in the first 2 years of our strategic framework. Second, outline the key reflections from the midterm review of our strategic framework. And third, reaffirm UNV's position as a partner and innovative-oriented organization, and invite all board members and partners to participate in the shaping of UNV in the final 2 years of the current strategic framework and looking ahead at the period of 2018 and 2021. Madam President, in highlighting the programmatic and institutional results that UNV has delivered in the first 2 years of our strategic framework, some 2015 UNV facts and figures to provide a sense of the size and scale. Nearly 6,800 qualified and committed UN volunteers from 153 nationalities serve in 122 countries. As a matter of fact, if you would check the fact sheets in front of you, you will be able to see, as board members, exactly the number of volunteers that your country has provided. Belgium has provided 61 volunteers last year. And the total number, actually, of volunteers provided by the executive board members that are here today is 2,300, in other words, nearly one-third. UN volunteers serve with nearly 30 UN agency partners, the top five being DPKO-DPA, UNDP, UNHCR, UNICEF, and UNFPA. 11,800 online volunteers contributed 19,000 online assignments, serving with 28 UN agency partners and some 1,700 non-governmental organizations. Our volunteers reported in 2015 that they reached out to nearly 6 million beneficiaries and continue to increase the number. Through our integrated results and resources matrix, UNV delivered a step change in how it systematically measures program and institutional performance against midterm performance milestone targets. With nearly two-thirds of the active indicators meeting or exceeding target, UNV has delivered a significant positive base of results at midterm, for which I provide you some highlights. Mobilization of UN volunteers in support of the United Nations system's country-level activities was a key success for UNV during 2014 and 15. For the first time since 2010, UNV increased the annual number of volunteers mobilized to nearly 6,800, with 83% of these UN volunteers from countries in the Global South. We are incredibly proud of that 83% figure, especially as it matches closely with the global demographic, with 84% of the global population residing in the Global South. UNV can by rights say that we are a significant expression of South-South cooperation in the United Nations system. Some 43% of the UN volunteers are women. This is a 3% increase over the last biennium, which coupled with a 2% increase reported 2 years ago, demonstrates a consistent, gradual, positive progress that UNV is making towards gender balance. Only volunteers who feel supported and protected by their host organization can be expected to deliver their professional inputs to the UN system. UNV therefore takes great care to look after the UN volunteers, and in 2015, 92% of all UN volunteers reported a positive volunteer experience. We focused on improving their experience, and in the past two years delivered a UN volunteer learning strategy and launched revised conditions of service for international United Nations volunteers. Following in-depth consultations with our UN partners and with international volunteer-involving organizations, UNV can state that its practices are currently best in class. The UNV online service continued to grow with 480,000 registered users from 180 countries. A 2014 evaluation highlighted how UNV is expanding online volunteerism globally and broadening volunteer opportunities, particularly for people with disabilities, women, and volunteers from developing countries. In 2014 and 15, 2% of the online volunteers mobilized were people with disabilities, 59% were female, and 62% were from countries of the Global South. On 18 April 2016, UNV and Samsung Corporation announced a corporate partnership for online volunteer services. This is the first of a series of corporate partnerships for UNV as part of our goal to expand the global reach of online volunteering and to explore innovative methods and partnerships to ensure the broadest participation possible. As envisioned in the strategic framework, UNV has developed a new pipeline of joint programs and projects at the country level, which has enabled us to shape, with governments and civil society, the role that volunteers and voluntarism play in tackling sustainable development challenges. To date, the first generation of new projects has been endorsed, with $5 million from the UNV Special Voluntary Fund invested in joint UN projects. This strategically leverage a total financial resource envelope of nearly $90 million in commitments from other partners. That is an 18-fold multiplier effect to prove how volunteers and voluntarism can make UN joint programs more sustainable, more impactful, and more human. In 2015, UNV produced the second State of the World Volunteerism Report, this time delivering a unique focus on transforming governance. A global review of the role of voluntarism in improving the way citizens are engaged and activated in national and subnational governance processes. The report was launched in New York, Nairobi, New Delhi, Bahrain, Tokyo, and Panama City. It provides evidence from around the world on how formal and informal volunteers engage with governance actors to strengthen participation, accountability, and responsiveness. UNV support was also instrumental in convening and facilitating the engagement of international and national volunteer-involving organizations in the post-2015 consultative process, including national dialogues and key United Nations consultations. At the global level, with support of UNV, a newly formed post-2015 volunteer group positioned volunteerism in the new development agenda and its implementation. UNV further deepened its South-South engagement by co-hosting in 2015 the International Volunteer Services Exchange Conference with the Beijing Volunteer Services Federation in China, with 18 member states participating. With this, a new platform was created for South-South knowledge sharing and information exchange on volunteerism amongst middle-income countries. Specifically, the conference resulted in an agreement to deploy joint humanitarian response teams of volunteers from the South to the South. Madam President, in operational terms, UNV has become more effective and efficient, with improved systems, business practices and processes, well-managed resources and engaged personnel. We operationalized our institutional effectiveness across 7 pillars, within which indicators, baselines and targets were established and delivered upon. There were 4 major areas of focus for UNV on institutional effectiveness during 2014 and 15: strengthening results-based management, enhanced partnerships and communication, better UN volunteer management, and improved human resources and operations. The launch of the strategic framework 2014-17 represented a first step in the evolution of UNV strategic thinking, results and orientation. In order to implement and operationalize the strategic framework and the integrated results and resources matrix, comprehensive sub-strategies and policies were developed. This included a UN volunteer mobilization and management strategy, 5 global programs, a UNV learning strategy, and more. Institutionally, this also included strategies for an integrated budget, human resources, communications, partnerships, information and communications technology, and more. To round this off, UNV adopted a new corporate planning process similar to that of UNDP, culminating in organizational annual business plans for 2014 and 15. This more structured way of operating necessitated structural changes that transformed UNV's human resources in the organization. UNV launched a new human resources strategy, transforming the organization from headquarters-based to global enhanced field presences at regional and country levels. At the end of 2015, UNV has 300 personnel, 58% of which were deployed at the regional and country level. A major step was the establishment of 4 regional offices in Nairobi, Dakar, Panama City, and Bangkok, to strengthen the capacity at the regional level, provide UNV field units with business intelligence, program advisory and partnership capacity, and to simply bring our product closer to our partners. Finally, in operational terms, I'm happy to report that UNV has made great progress on gender balance of UNV personnel. 60% of the personnel are female, and female representation at senior management level, P5 and above, increased significantly to 54%, up from 38% in 2013. As I speak of human resources of the organization, I would like to express my profound thanks to all UNV personnel for their great care, commitment and engagement. They are a small team doing great things for peace and development. In terms of UNV's financial performance, three midterm messages clearly emerge. First, the significance of UN volunteer mobilization and management as a core function of UNV. Secondly, the importance of regular core resources provided by member states to UNV through UNDP. And finally, the crucial role that the Special Volunteer Fund plays, providing seed funding for innovative projects. To be clear, as core funding reduced and UN volunteer numbers have not picked up yet sufficiently, we have reduced operating costs, especially at headquarters, and we have drawn from our strategic reserves. UNV has been willing to do so and take on small deficits because we strongly believe that we are making the right investments and are coming up with the right innovations. Madam President, at the midterm of our strategic framework overall, there are three reflections to highlight. First, adjustments to the Agenda 2030 is critical for UNV, more so as our UN partners will be adjusting, which changes the demand for our services. The SDGs call upon UNV's central mandate to engage all available resources and foster broad participation in pursuit of a shared development agenda. Mobilization and civic engagement are at the very heart of volunteerism, and as the planet is challenging itself to sustainably change, this is one of the ways to ensure that as many people as possible are bound in. Isn't that what unleashing transformative capacities of people is all about? Implementing the Plan of Action on Volunteerism, approved by the General Assembly Resolution 17-129, is a major opportunity for leveraging these transformative capacities of people and building transformational partnerships to deliver solutions. The Plan of Action has three strategic objectives. A, to strengthen people's ownership and the development agenda through broadening civic engagement. B, integrate volunteerism into national and global implementation strategies for the Sustainable Development Goals. And C, measure the transformative impact of volunteerism. Strong commitment and partnerships amongst government, academia, and United Nations system is very important for the successful implementation. We are therefore very, very proud to report that we are working very closely together with the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies in bringing this plan of action about. And UNV is seeking the Executive Board's agreement to consult regularly on that plan of action as part of the informal consultations with the Board. This would be an effective and efficient mechanism to regularly consult, provide guidance and oversight of the implementation of the plan of action. The second important reflection at the midterm, as noted earlier, is implementing the strategic framework has been a learning process in strengthening UNV's results-based management. Moreover, strategic adjustments in UNV continue to reorient it within an evolving development landscape towards being a partner and innovative-focused organization poised to deliver greater results and returns in 2016 and 17. Finally, UNV will maintain an ambitious outlook, especially as regards to UN volunteer mobilization and resource mobilization, both vital for the development impact and financial sustainability of UNV on the long term. Madam President, as I'm going to wrap up, the UNV strategic transformation is underway and will provide critical inputs for the development of the next UNV strategic framework for 2018 to 2021. We strongly welcome further engagement of the Board and our partners as we continue along this journey. Our strategic evolution and innovation is only possible with strong partnerships. First, with our UN partners like UNDP and the Department of Field Services, and also with major players like the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Society. Contributions to the Special Voluntary Fund are critical for the continued innovation in integrating volunteers and volunteerism in the work of the United Nations as it starts tackling sustainable development goals. UNV has had Special Volunteer Fund partnerships during the biennium with the governments of Bahrain, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Czech Republic, China, Germany, India, Ireland, Israel, Lao People's Democratic Republic, Morocco, Switzerland, Sweden, and Thailand. I would like to seize the opportunity to reaffirm the importance of partnerships for UNV. I would like to seek further dialogue with you on the evolution of UNV, on fully funded UN volunteers, on the Special Voluntary Fund, on our 5 programs, and more. For this, I warmly invite all of you to our next UNV Partnership Forum in October 2016. This will take place in our home, Bonn, Germany, and we will be focusing on revitalizing partnerships, volunteering for the SDGs. In collaboration with the German Federal Ministry of Economic Cooperation and Development and the City of Bonn, we are excited at the prospect of welcoming member states such as China and partners such as CUSO, ECOWAS, FK Norway, Forum, France Volontaire, JICA, COICA, Peace Corps, VSO and more, but also our new corporate sector partners such as Credit Suisse, DHL, IBM, Impact 2030, Medtronic, Microsoft, Philips, Samsung, SAP and more. At the forum, we will have spaces to discuss specifically on South-South cooperation, corporate sector volunteering, the UNV global programs, online volunteering and more. The forum will also showcase the experiences of our volunteers, demonstrating the profound impact that volunteering has had on their lives and on the lives of those around them. Frankly, 20 minutes every 2 years in an executive board meeting is not enough for me to explain the value that our small but powerful organization is making for development. And I do hope that you will be able to take the time to join us and see for yourself. Thank you very much.
I thank Mr. Gietu for his presentation and Mr. Dictus for his own presentation. And now I will open the floor for questions and comments from delegations. I have 11 speakers on my list, and we start with Japan, followed by Sweden. Japan, the Deputy Permanent Representative of Japan, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Madam President. At the outset, I would like to extend my sincere appreciation to Associate Administrator Mr. Tegegetu for the introduction, and also the Executive Coordinator Mr. Richard Dictus for the very excellent and comprehensive presentation. Japan has been supporting the work of UNV for many years. First, we were very proud to co-facilitate the UN General Assembly Resolution 70/129 on integrating volunteering into peace and development, which was adopted by consensus last year. My delegation thanks the co-sponsors for strong and broad support, and also my delegation really appreciate the co-facilitator, Brazil, for the hard work. Japan feels this is an important resolution for volunteerism, as it sets a course for all relevant stakeholders to follow, and the global actions for integrating volunteering in peace and development from 2016 to 2030. Japan is a supporter for the implementation and looks forward to the global technical meeting to be held in the year 2020. The plan of action should ensure that the efforts of multiple stakeholders are leveraged for more people to utilize volunteerism as a vehicle to engage in implementing the SDGs. Second, as outlined in the biennial report, UNV has focused on strengthening its partnerships over the past 2 years. We have seen this during a number of strategic dialogues held between Japan and UNV. The second strategic dialogue held in October last year, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Japan, UNV, reaffirmed the future collaboration in areas such as disaster risk reduction, peace building, global health, gender and women's empowerment, and TICAD. We are content that the strategic framework 2014-17 is emphasizing the importance of the people-centered approach, inclusiveness, and building resilience. Third, Japan has been a major donor to UNB with contributions through the Japan Trust Fund and Human Resource Development for Peace Building through volunteer assignments, which is called HRD. Japan attaches great value to working with UNB for HRD for peace building and puts great emphasis on the importance of field experience as UN volunteers for the HRD associates from not only Japan but also Asia, Middle East, and African countries. They are able to make significant contributions towards improving the lives of the people affected by crises. Between 2007 and 2015, a total of 146 UNB HRD volunteers completed UN volunteer assignments. They provided support to more than 16 United Nations agencies and partner organizations, delivering humanitarian assistance and improving basic services for vulnerable people in 44 countries. Fourth, we welcome that UNB conducted its midterm review of the strategic framework to assess overall progress made against strategic targets and to review the strategic framework direction in the context of the new agenda. We also appreciate UNB for the program outcome and output performance, which saw nearly two-thirds of the indicators meeting or exceeding performance. We note that UNB has delivered a significant positive base of program results at midterm. We welcome UNB's results and highlight the efforts of thousands of volunteers giving their time and dedication to the betterment of the world. Looking ahead, we look forward to the continued strategic transformation of UNB as it develops the next strategic framework, 2018-2021. Finally, I would like to reiterate our commitment and support for the UNB. I thank you very much, Madam President.
I thank the representative of Japan, and I would like to give the floor to Sweden, who will be then followed by Haiti. Sweden, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And thanks also to the Associate Administrator for his introductory remarks. Sweden would like to express its gratitude to the UNV Executive Coordinator for an excellent report and valuable contributions to the UNV's work. UNV is a relatively unnoticed entity in the UN family, one that often conducts its important work with little attention. Sweden, as a long-standing partner to UNV, therefore welcomes this opportunity to say a few words in response to the statement made by the Executive Coordinator and to highlight some of our experience from cooperation with UNV. Sweden indeed appreciates UNV as a partner for dialogue and co-creation of new working methods in development cooperation. Innovative methods that engage new actors, such as the private sector, allows UNV to broker timely and relevant volunteer support to meet rapidly changing needs. To mention a recent example, we are proud of having initiated, together with UNV, a promising pilot for facilitating contributions to the SDGs from a variety of actors through a new tailor-made online volunteering platform. One of UNV's strengths is that UNV provides modern and innovative mechanisms for South-South cooperation. The high and steady increasing numbers of volunteers from the South is a success story. 83%, as we heard, of its field volunteers and 58% of its online volunteers are from the South. This reflects UNV's ability to adapt and remain relevant in a constantly changing environment. Sweden appreciates UNV's capacity to learn, adapt, and collaborate with and through other UN entities, and the positive feedback from clients speaks its own language. Madam Chair, with almost half of the world's poor expected to live in countries affected by fragility, conflict, and violence by 2030, Sweden is deeply engaged in efforts to end conflicts and build and sustain peaceful societies. UNV provides a significant share of civilian personnel in UN peacekeeping operations, and Sweden appreciates this important contribution by UNV to promote lasting peace and stability. Many of UNV's 7,000 volunteers in the field work in these difficult contexts. Many of these volunteers work in these difficult contexts, and they provide critical operational capacity. Sweden would also like to commend UNV for the high numbers of young volunteers, and efforts to reach young volunteers are made through the youth modality. 60% of the online volunteers are young. The steady trend towards closing on the equilibrium in number of men and women volunteers is very positive. And thanks for making this information available through gender disaggregated indicators and data. Madam Chair, the willingness to contribute to a common good and spirit of solidarity are the characteristics of volunteerism that also permeates the Swedish policy for global development and makes possible generous contributions from Swedish public to poverty reduction, including through UN and UNV. Sweden is one of the key contributors of core resources to UNV through the special voluntary fund. These flexible resources enable UNV to develop and run innovative and pilot projects, demonstrating the role that volunteerism and volunteers can play in peace and in development. Sweden notes with concern the downward trend in funding and encourages other member states to consider supporting UNV. UNV's strategy to create a leaner and more focused organization with renewed efforts to tap into new, non-traditional resource mobilization opportunities and a reinvigorated product line is welcomed. Last but perhaps most important, Sweden extends its gratitude to UNV staff and volunteers for their dedicated work, especially those working in difficult environments. Your efforts are noticed and much appreciated. Thanks for your attention.
I thank the representative of Sweden, and I would now like to give the floor to the representative of Haiti. Vous avez la parole.
You have the floor, madam. Thank you, Madam Chairman. Allow me at the outset to express appreciation to the Associate Administrator for his preliminary comments and also to thank the Executive Director of the UN Volunteers Program for the high quality of the report, which will help to optimize the work of the executive board of the program. Haiti is very interested in participating in this meeting, given the important role played by volunteers and volunteerism in Haitian society. In this respect, we appreciate the longstanding partnership of the UNV program in Haiti, and more than 200 UN volunteers, national and foreign, which are working at present in Haiti, together with United Nations funds and programs and agencies, together with MINUSTAB. More specifically, Haiti welcomes the two recent initiatives which should be mentioned. First of all, the formation of the Haitian Network of Local Associations. This is partnership between the Ministry of Youth, Sports and Civic Action of Haiti and the UNV program, which has made it possible to create a network forming Haitian civil society organizations, volunteer organizations, and local NGOs. The goal is to bring them together through a unique platform in the framework of several projects and initiatives, for example, the follow-up of the common capacity-building program for Haitian youth. This platform is also recognized at the international level and has represented the Haitian youth in different regional and international forums, such as CARICOM. Secondly, the establishment of forums of different regional and international of volunteer brigades for the reduction of risks of a disaster, and this initiative is a partnership with the Ministry of the Interior and Territorial Collectives of Haiti and the UNV program and the UNDP, and seeks to strengthen decentralization of the national disaster risk reduction program and is scheduled to begin in Haiti in July 2016. My delegation is proud to note that 60 Haitian nationals are currently serving as international volunteers in the United Nations in 13 countries. These Volunteers play a very important role in promoting peace and in development by providing their expertise in areas such as information and communication and technology, public information training, electoral support and security. In this respect, it should be noted that the largest contingent of Haitian nationals working as UN volunteers is in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, a country which in turn has provided 10 Congolese nationals to work as volunteers in Haiti. In both cases, they help to develop capacities in the host countries and in this way represent a very good example of South-South cooperation. Haiti also welcomes the service of the online volunteers of the UNV program. In particular, we're happy to note that in 2015, 12 Haitian nationals served as online volunteers, and 14 online missions of the volunteers were provided in Haiti. Madam Chair, with respect specifically to the semi-annual report of the UNV program, my delegation welcomes with satisfaction the midterm review of the strategic framework of UNV with the view to evaluating the overall progress made with respect to the strategic objectives, identifying challenges and opportunities, and to review the orientation of the strategic framework within the context of the post-2015 Sustainable Development Program. My delegation believes that the performance of the UNV program is commendable, and it shows that this is shown particularly in the following statistics concerning 2015. Approximately 6,400 UN volunteers are working throughout the world, 83% from the South, and 43% are women. 11,800 volunteers online volunteers of the United Nations, provide assistance through 19,000 missions, online missions. 5.1 million people benefit from, in a positive way, from the UNV program. And with respect to the operational aspects, the report emphasizes clearly that the UNV program has stressed a number of things, and we welcome in particular the strategic reorientation, the internal alignment, and the strengthening of management, results-based management. These are strategic investments that can be expected to provide results and better outcomes for the period 2016-2017 and beyond. My government welcomes the transparency and the sense of responsibility shown by the UNV program within the report, and welcomes the ideas which are articulated, in particular with respect to the adjustment towards the 2030 agenda. We welcome also the UNV program, that it takes into account now better, more ambitious objectives with respect to the mobilization of UN volunteers and the mobilization of resources as well, two elements which are vitally necessary for the development and financial viability of the UNV in the long term. To conclude, my delegation is aware that the UNV program will continue to evolve on the basis of the 2013 agenda, and in particular through its partnership with the United Nations agencies. While the agencies themselves will proceed making their own adjustments, my delegation is awaiting with interest the continued transfer strategic transformation of the UNV program, together with the development of its forthcoming 2018-2021 strategic framework, and we're eager to make our modest contribution to this transformation in future. Thank you. I thank the representative of Haiti, and I now give the floor to the Republic of Korea. You have the floor. Switzerland, followed by Korea.
Madam President, thank you very much for giving me the floor. We wish to thank the Executive Coordinator, Mr. Richard Dictus, and his team for UNV's great performance as presented in the report on results and achievements of the United Nations Volunteers Program in implementing its strategic framework 2014-17. The report provides a clear and frank midterm review on accomplishments and challenges. We take note with appreciation of the UNV program outcome and output performance, which saw nearly two-thirds of the indicators meeting or exceeding performance. This achievement at midterm highlights both UNV's successful efforts to drive its mission and is also the result of thousands of volunteers giving their time and dedication to make the world a better place. There also seem to be some areas where UNV needs to accelerate progress. We encourage UNV increasing its efforts to advocate that other United Nations entities apply innovative, needs-driven, programmatic agreements for the mobilization of UN volunteers. Furthermore, UNV needs to increase its support to countries for the domestic mobilization of volunteers through national or regional volunteering schemes. Enhanced efforts in these fields will help to deepen UNV's critical role as a common service provider to the United Nations and for promoting volunteerism globally to achieve the 2030 agenda. We note with satisfaction that UNV implemented a wide range of activities successfully. We particularly welcome the strategic reorientation, internal alignment, and strengthened results-based management. As also reflected in the report, continued efforts are needed that UNV becomes a partner for many development actors and an innovation-focused organization poised to deliver greater results and returns in 2016 to 17. All these elements are key for UNV's successful response to the 2030 agenda. To conclude, let me say the following. Switzerland is supporting UNV as one of the top donors to UNV's Special Voluntary Fund. In 2015, the Swiss government contributed $845,000. We appreciate in particular that this fund allows UNV to finance pilot initiatives that test and demonstrate the relevance and added value of volunteerism to sustainable development. We also appreciate that the Special Voluntary Fund is an expression of ownership of the program by countries from the south as well as the north, noting that 63 countries have contributed since its inception, 42 of these are the developing countries. We would welcome other countries in a position to do so, to join Switzerland in expressing our support for volunteerism and UNV by contributing to the Special Voluntary Fund. We look forward to continue engaging with UNV as it develops the next strategic framework 2018 to 2021. Thank you very much for your attention.
I thank the representative of Switzerland, and I now give the floor to the Republic of Korea, who will be followed by the Russian Federation. So I give now the floor to the representative of the Republic of Korea. Please.
Madam President, let me begin by thanking Executive Coordinator Mr. Richard Dictus for his very comprehensive and useful statement. My delegation welcomes UNV's midterm review of the strategic framework, which assesses overall progress regarding strategic targets, challenges, and opportunities, and review the strategic framework's direction in the context of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. We are pleased to see that the quality of the report has been improved by systematically measuring UNV's program and institutional performance through the integrated results and resources metrics. In particular, we commend UNV on its program outcome and output performance, with nearly two-thirds of indicators meeting or exceeding expectations. We would also like to recognize the dedication of thousands of volunteers to the betterment of the world. On UNV's operation, it is clear from the report that UNV has focused on a variety of elements. In particular, we welcome the strategic reorientation, internal alignment, and strengthened result-based management highlighted. The report also shows how important the regular core resources provided by member states to UNV through UNDP are to UNV's operational base in order to deliver its core mandate. We recognize the crucial roles of the Special Voluntary Fund, as well as fully funded UN volunteers, for which the Republic of Korea is a strong partner. My government also welcomes the reflection articulated by UNV in the midterm report, especially in adjusting towards the 2030 agenda. We appreciate the strategic adjustment reorienting towards being a partner and innovation-focused organization, which is poised to deliver greater results and returns in 2016-2017. We look forward to the continued strategic transformation of UNV as it develops the next strategic framework 2018-2021. Madam President, since UNV and the Republic of Korea established formal ties in 1986, our partnership with UNV has continued to grow and expand. My government has increased its contributions to UNV, and in 2015, we became UNV's third biggest donor and second largest fully funded specialist contributor. In particular, UNV and the Korea International Cooperation Agency, or COICA, signed the COICA UN University Volunteer Fully Funded Agreement in 2015. Under this agreement, the first batch of 15 UNV COICA volunteers was selected and deployed to 10 countries around the world. Among those volunteers, a Korean national serving as a UN youth volunteer with UNDP in Uzbekistan supported the Social Innovation and Volunteerism Project as a community outreach specialist. The team, which included 7 national UN volunteers, launched a creative workshop called Garbage Lab, which brought together some 40 young people, including persons with disabilities. The workshop raised environmental awareness by showing people how to reuse materials to make furniture, which they otherwise could not afford, and also encouraged cooperation between youth and persons with disabilities. The project was eventually selected by UNDP to be scaled up nationwide as a DIY lab. Madam President, we believe that the Republic of Korea and UNV partnership will only grow and move forward, and hope that our efforts in this area can help expand and enhance the cause of international volunteering as a cross-cutting means of implementation for sustainable development. Thank you.
I thank the representative of the Republic of Korea, and now I give the floor to the representative of the Russian Federation, who will be followed by Germany. You have the floor, Russian Federation.
Thank you, madam, for giving me the floor. Госпожа председатель.
Madam Chair, we would like to thank the Executive Director of the UN Volunteers Program for the thorough presentation, as well as for the comprehensive report that was prepared on the UNV program's activities for 2014-2015. We are grateful to all participants in the UNV for the contribution they have made at the global level in the period under consideration. We commend the midterm results of the achievements of the UNV under the strategic plan for 2014-2017. Although some target indicators in the reporting period were not fully achieved, we value the high level of transparency and accountability of the UN volunteers, which has been shown in the current report. We have also taken note of the midterm financial analysis for 2014-2015 and would like to reaffirm the significance of core resources for the operational base of UN volunteers in order to implement the basic mandate of the program, as well as the role of the Special Voluntary Fund as an integral element of UN volunteers' resources. Madam Chair, one of the most noble forms of activity under the program is carried out by more than 6,500 volunteers, among which there are Russian citizens, as well as 11,500 online volunteers throughout the world. These people were able to provide support to more than 5 million aid recipients. The organization has demonstrated a high level of cohesiveness and readiness to develop partnership relationships, cooperating with 28 UN agencies through their efforts to ensure peace and development. Having said that, we know the need for further development of partnerships with scientific, private, and non-governmental sectors when implementing projects in the context of implementation of the Sustainable Agenda, or Agenda 2030. We welcome the efforts of UNV in the implementation of GE resolution on integrating volunteering into peace and development. And we expect that the organization of the global meeting in 2020 will serve to increase the involvement of volunteers in implementing Agenda 2030. We appreciate the GA resolution 7129 on integrating volunteering into peace and development, and expect that the 2020 global meeting will further involve volunteers in all activities for the implementation of the 2030 agenda. Madam Chair, we note with satisfaction the dynamic of development of the partnership with the Russian Federation and the UNV program. Recently in Moscow, there was a seminar on volunteering held and on the program of development of international and Russian experience. During this meeting, there was an exchange of opinions on the strategies and experience of work of the UNV program and volunteer organizations in Russia. There was also a discussion on multilateral cooperation for the development and promotion of volunteer movements in Russia from outside of Russia. Representatives of the UNV and Russian agencies, state corporations, as well as academic institutions and NGOs took place in the meeting and seminars. Taking into account the work the Russian Federation has carried out with the UNVs, there is much that has been accomplished. Thank you very much.
I thank the representative of the Russian Federation for his statement, and now I would like to give the floor to the representative of Germany, who will be followed by Guinea. So, representative of Germany, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We wish to congratulate UNV for its successful shift towards an organization that has virtually reinvented itself. UNV, as it stands today, is a more strategic as well as partner and client-focused organization. UNV is aware of its value for member states and the UN system. It disposes of a robust results orientation, strengthened internal governance, and a reshaped strategic thinking. The straightforwardness and frankness of the report of the administrator is an excellent and much appreciated expression of this new spirit. We would like to thank the executive coordinator, Richard Dittus, and the entire personnel of UNV for its dedication and commitment to make these important organizational changes happen. We know that the UNV personnel is working tirelessly and with great passion. It is noted with appreciation that nearly two-thirds of the program indicators of the integrated results and resources matrix meet or exceed performance. These are various positive developments highlighted in the biennial report of the administrator. We are particularly pleased to see the merit of introducing the strategic framework and the continued investment in online volunteer mobilization. The cooperation with a network of international volunteer groups has led to their structural inclusion in the 2030 agenda process of implementation, monitoring, and review. We do welcome the rise in the number and of financial investments in joint UN programs and projects. UNV's revitalized engagement with the UN programming process, leading to 50 projects noted with a total financial envelope of $90 million in commitments from partners, is much appreciated. We also note with appreciation that UNV continues to play an important role in South-South cooperation, as 83% of all volunteers and 58% of the international volunteers come from the Global South. At the same time, we are very pleased about the renewed commitment on gender equality. The percentage of UNV UN partner programs that integrate gender equality and the empowerment of women increased from 44 to 88%. Another area where UNV has made remarkable progress is the broadening of the knowledge base on the value of volunteerism. UNV exceeded its indicator for the support of studies on volunteerism in peace and development. It enhanced engagement with academia, research institutions, civil society, and volunteerism experts and researchers. In our opinion, This investment is an important precondition for UNV's new standards in results-based management. As part of its strategic redirection towards partnerships, UNV hosted the first ever partnerships forum in Bonn in 2014. The event brought together over 100 representatives from UN entities, governments, academia, volunteer organizations, and the private sector in an innovative format. We applaud UNV for this proactive and coherent management of its partnerships, and we look forward to the new partnerships forum in October to discuss further projects and services. We agree with UNV that it is best approach to maintain an ambitious outlook as regards UN volunteer mobilization and resource mobilization. At the same time, we would like to emphasize that the qualitative growth of the program is essential and even more important in the long run than reaching the 10,000 volunteers mobilized annually. It is important that UNV keeps a healthy balance between its activities in the area of volunteer mobilization and management, advocacy work, and the support of country-led volunteer schemes. We encourage UNV to step up its support for national, regional, and subnational volunteer schemes. Finally, allow me to say some words on Germany's long-standing cooperation and excellent relationship with UNV. We are very proud to host the UNV headquarters in Bonn, and we continue efforts to jointly promote and enlarge the UN city of Bonn. Germany is the main bilateral donor of UNV with a contribution of $5.7 million in the year 2014. We annually provide €1.7 million for the Special Voluntary Fund. The fund allows UNV to innovate and to take proven innovations to scale. In addition, we provide non-core funds and invest in areas such as online volunteering, results-based management, gender-responsive peace-building, and the support of the peace process in Mali. The online volunteering program aims at engaging the private sector and develops innovative ways of cooperation. Further, we also decided to focus on supporting the UN resident coordinators' offices as part of our overall engagement for the delivering as one approach. We have to say that UNV has demonstrated to us that this organization is a responsive, proactive, and results-focused partner. We do hope that other member states will also take a further look at engaging in new and innovative partnerships with UNV. From our experience, we would think that they will exceed expectations. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
I thank the representative of Germany. I have two more member states on my list. So if there are, which are Guinea and Nepal. If there are any other member states who wish to take the floor after Nepal, please press your button. Et maintenant,
I now have the pleasure of giving the floor to the representative of Guinea. Thank you very much, Madam Chair. First of all, I wish to thank the Associate Administrator of UNDP, and also to thank Mr. Richard Dictus, the Executive Coordinator of the UN Volunteers Program, for his exhaustive statement on the report of the Administrator. My delegation welcomes the progress made with regard to the implementation of the 2014-2017 strategic program of the UNV program, and we welcome the transparency of the presentation of the midterm results. Madam Chair, the effective implementation of Agenda 2030 requires the mobilization of all human resources available within the United Nations, including volunteers. The positive impact of their action at the local level in particular means that the volunteers and volunteerism have pride of place in the work of the United Nations entities. Volunteerism very often goes hand in hand with the young people because it represents, for a number of young people, not only the first way to enter the professional world, but also an opportunity to acquire the personal and professional skills they need to find employment on the international scene, which is increasingly competitive. My delegation welcomes the increase in the number of volunteers under age 30 from 14% in 2014 to 23% in 2015, as mentioned in the report, and we encourage the UN program to continue to incorporate women and young people in the empowerment their empowerment is a prerequisite for the strengthening of peace and sustainable development. We also welcome the fact that 83% of the volunteers are from the South, and this accounts for 58% of the international volunteers. As the statistics show, a number of young people from our countries have competence and experience to work in difficult contexts. However, frequently they don't have access to the information or tools they need to engage in international volunteerism. In this respect, we encourage the program to strengthen further the dissemination of information on vacancies and the procedures for candidacies for young people, particularly those from the countries of the South. Madam Chairman, volunteerism plays an important role in the social economic development of countries. Volunteers also play a decisive role on many fronts in responding to the Ebola virus. They have also participated in a number of campaigns to heighten awareness of local communities and to mobilize young people volunteers on the measures to be taken to prevent disease, the distribution of food to the affected population, to accompany or provide psychosocial care for orphans, or also to strengthen capacities for prevention services. We are grateful for the support of the UNV program for the efforts on the part of the government in the context not only of responding to the Ebola epidemic, but also the post-Ebola recovery. Guinea is prepared to strengthen its partnership with the UNV program to strengthen the capacities of our volunteers and to make it possible to express fully their competences at the national or international level. Madam Chair, we would like to conclude by supporting the courageous ambition of the program to maintain the goals of its strategic framework 2014-27, particularly with respect to the creation and strengthening of volunteer programs at the national and regional level, despite the challenges encountered in their implementation. Thank you. I thank the representative of Guinea for his statement.
Of Nepal, who will be followed by the United Nations Department of Field Support if there are no other member states requesting the floor after Nepal. Nepal, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair, for giving me the floor. At the outset, let me express my sincere thanks to the administrator of UNDP, Ms. Helen Clark, for her report on United Nations volunteers, which presents an overview of results achieved by UNDP during the years 2014 and 15. I express my sincere appreciation to the Associate Administrator for his introductory remarks highlighting the values and activities of UNV. I also appreciate Mr. Richard Dictus, Executive Coordinator of UNV, for presenting the report in a comprehensive manner and congratulate him and the whole UNV family for the progress made and result achieved during the last 2 years. In its almost 45 years of history, with core objective of contributing to the promotion of peace and development, UNV has, through providing trained, skilled, and motivated volunteers, significantly contributed to the realization of the objective of United Nations in general and all program countries in particular. The promotion of volunteerism by mobilizing volunteers for humanitarian peace building, post-conflict recovery, as well as sustainable development and poverty eradication related activities has helped UN reach to the level of common people and promote civic engagement for peace and development. We welcome that UNV conducted its midterm review of the strategic framework to assess overall progress made against strategic targets, assess challenges and opportunities, and review the strategic direction in the context of new SDGs agenda. We also appreciate UNV's program performance, which mobilized nearly 6,800 UN volunteers, with 80% from the South and 43% being female. Operationally, it is clear that from the report that UNV has focused on many elements, particularly the strategic reorientation, internal alignment, and strengthen result-based management, which helped them to be fit for purpose in the context of the new development agenda. This is well reflected in the UNV report, especially adjusting towards Agenda 2030. Madam Chair, volunteerism and volunteer service is one of the strong elements in the Nepalese society. That's why Nepal has always been supportive of the activities of UNV. The UNV began to work in my country, Nepal, since 1974 with the arrival of the first volunteer to work for UNICEF. Since then, it has been part of the capacity building of citizens, mobilization of local people in development activities, local governance and community development program, and help strengthen the national development volunteer services. Among others, UNV should continue to looking at the linkages between volunteerism as a means to civic engagement, participation and inclusion, and the nationally defined development agenda. Following the devastating earthquake that struck Nepal in April, May last year, Nepalese volunteers were among the first responders and were in the forefront. UN volunteers were also part of the response and early recovery, for example, as part of UNDP's debris management project, assisting safe demolition of affected infrastructure. You can see in the cover of the delivering at the grassroots annual report, the one photo of the activities conducted by UNV in Nepal. With reconstruction efforts underway and role of volunteers recognized as a key actor amidst others in the post-disaster recovery framework, the government of Nepal and the National Development Volunteer Services will be working together with UNV and UN agencies to integrate volunteers and volunteerism within the framework of various activities and programs. It will also be relevant to mention here that Nepalese nationals are the sixth largest communities to serve as international UN volunteers abroad. In 2015, nearly 100 Nepali nationals served as international volunteers in various parts of the globe for the noble cause of development and peace. Madam Chair, presently we are facing with daunting challenges to eradicate poverty and promote sustainable development. We are also trying to overcome the devastation caused by massive earthquake and reconstruction works. Moreover, we are in the process of integration of Agenda 2030 for the sustainable development, including the SDGs, in our national development plan and strategy. UNV's continued support will be of relevance to all these national agendas. With its priorities outlined in its strategic framework for 2014 to 2017, is securing access to basic social services, community resilience for environment and disaster risk reduction, peace building, youth and capacity development. We believe that UNV can make significant strides in contributing to the sustainable development and promotion of peace, thereby supporting our aforementioned national agendas. In this context, UNV needs further reorientation and institutional revamp in order to fulfill its responsibilities effectively and efficiently to fine-tune with new emerging challenges. I thank you, Madam Chair.
I thank the representative of Nepal, and now I would like to give the floor to the representative of the Department of Field Support. You have the floor.
Madam Chair, as Acting Assistant Secretary General, on behalf of the Department of Peacekeeping Operations, the Department of Political Affairs, and the Department of Field Support, I have the honor to address the 2016 annual session of the Executive Board of UNDP, UNOPS, and UNFPA. We extend our utmost support and appreciation to the UNV program for the support that UNV and its UN volunteers continue to provide to peacekeeping and peacebuilding efforts. Madam Chair, we are pleased to highlight to the Board the outstanding collaboration with UNV. UNV is an integral ally in support of peace and security activities in United Nations field missions. This was illustrated in the 2014-15 biennium through the participation of over 2,500 UN volunteers annually in our peacekeeping and special political missions spread over 17 countries. Along with civilian, military, and police personnel, UN volunteers often serve in the most difficult conditions. In many UN missions, UN volunteers constitute over one-third of the international civilian personnel components. UNV has been a key partner in deploying surge capacities at the startup phases of a number of UN missions and have been instrumental in the implementation of local capacity development strategies, which a number of missions have put in place in recent years. Quite simply put, the UN could not deploy and Security Council mandates could not be delivered without UNV. Reflecting the increasingly diverse and complex mandates the Security Council entrusts peacekeeping and special political missions, UN volunteers have undertaken human rights monitoring, child protection activities. They have served in civil affairs and disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration operations. They have provided electoral assistance. They have built judicial capacities and assisted in strengthening prisons and correction systems. The diversity and complexity of locations in which we work demonstrates the peace and security challenges being addressed by the UN today, but it also speaks of the flexibility, resourcefulness, and responsiveness of UNV as an organization. UN volunteers are highly valued for their ability to engage communities, to contribute to rebuilding the compact between a state and its citizens, to foster mutual trust between communities, and to engage young people as active agents of peace, all of which respond to the ever-increasing call for more people to focus on the international peace and security agenda, as amongst others expressed in the 2015 High-Level Independent Panel on Peace Operations, the HIPPO report, and Security Council Resolution 2250 on Youth, Peace, and Security. We at DFS, DPKO, and DFPA consistently see in UN volunteers an extraordinary commitment to the ideals of the organization, which is something that you, as member states, with many of your nationals serving as UN volunteers, should be proud of. Madam Chair, over the past biennium, UNV was a key partner in new operations in Burundi, the Central African Republic, and especially in UNMIR, the first ever UN emergency health mission operating in Guinea, Liberia, and Sierra Leone. UNV's support in quickly deploying the necessary capacities in UNMIR during its critical startup phase was much appreciated. In this effort, we sadly lost one UN volunteer, medical professional, and at this moment, we would like to pay tribute to Abdul Fadil Bashir Mohammed, who paid the ultimate price in the fight against Ebola. The DFS partnership with UNV will continue to evolve in 2016 and beyond as we continue our efforts to deliver the best possible support to our field missions to build and promote sustainable peace. A number of programmatic collaborations are being developed, such as with MINUSCA, with UN volunteers, fostering popular support of and access to and understanding of the Special Criminal Court project in the Central African Republic, with MINUSMA on the promotion of a culture of peace among young Malians, and with MINUSCO on local people's access to justice and community development in North Kivu. Madam Chair, once again, I wish to reiterate to member states and board members that we appreciate the efforts, dedication, and dynamism which UN volunteers bring in support of peace and development activities in United Nations field missions. We look forward to our continued strong partnership, and UNV can count on DFS's sustained support. Thank you.
I thank the representative of DFS, and I would like to give the floor to the last speaker on my list, the representative of the International Federation of the Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies. You have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and allow me to express our thanks to the Associate Administrator and UNV Executive Coordinator and the entire UNV team for their efforts, as well as for the recognition in Mr. Dictus's remarks of the kind collaboration with the Red Cross and Red Crescent. On behalf of the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, I would like to welcome the partnership with UNV, which has been significantly strengthened over the years and reflected in the General Assembly Resolution 70-129, which was entitled Integrating Volunteering into Peace and Development, the Plan of Action for the Next Decade and Beyond. In particular, the IFRC welcomes the planning for jointly organizing a global technical meeting in 2020 to further strengthen the engagement and contributions of volunteers with regard to the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, and looks forward to working with UNV, member states, volunteer-involving organization partners accordingly. I would like to note the areas of mutual cooperation between IFRC and UNV, especially on the promotion of volunteerism through our global networks, on knowledge and policy research to carry out more studies on the subject of volunteerism in order to build a body of evidence and to provide sound knowledge as a foundation for policies and programs in support of sustainable peace and development. Third, on efforts to enhance the protection, security, and well-being of volunteers. And fourth, highlighting the critical role of volunteers as first responders to emergencies, most recently jointly at the World Humanitarian Summit, at which the Secretary General of the IFRC, Mr. Al-Haj Assi, noted, I quote, "Volunteers are working within local communities to support, care, help, heal, and build social capital in order to find common solutions to humanitarian challenges." Madam Chair, the IFRC looks forward to the opportunity of working with UNV to build a 1 billion coalition of volunteers for resilience. I thank you.
I thank the representative of the International Federation of the Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies. And at this stage, I would like to give back the floor to Mr. Dictus for his comments and responses.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think there, for us, what we are hearing at this moment is an enormous amount of recognition for the work that we have undertaken over the last years to really significantly reposition ourselves. The fact that the report is being seen as very transparent and accountable based on the new strategic framework and the IRRM is extremely important for us. The fact that a number of member states mentioned the transformation and the visible transformation on terms of the realignment, the repositioning as an innovative and partnership-oriented organization and results-based management is, again, a recognition for us that we will take home and build on. Yes, a number of the member states have mentioned youth and young people, but in line with capacity development. And that is something we are very proud of as we are evolving, to be able to bring more young people into the development process, into social roles. The role of young people also, but in general, volunteers in peace and development is being recognized, as well as the fact that indeed we are, at this moment, a strong South-South organization. We are a common service for the United Nations system, as a number of you mentioned, and indeed we are part of bringing greater coherence in the system. We're very, very appreciative of the comments that were made on core resources, SVF, and the fact that the SVF fund is indeed owned both by the North and the South. And we would like to hope that that actually means that indeed we are an organization that is owned by all member states and that the discussion going forward in our strategic framework is one that involves all member states. We are very appreciative for those of you who have pledged support, and particularly Japan, for the platform, for the plan of action moving forward, as well as the call that we heard from a number of close partners such as Japan, Germany, Korea, Switzerland, Sweden, and others to engage more strongly with us. Any affirmation of partners such as Russia and other emerging friends that they indeed will do so. We are ready for this discussion, and we do hope that we will be able to all welcome you in Bonn in the next couple of months. The comments from Mr. Price from the I will be quoting you worldwide, sir. UN cannot deploy, Security Council mandates cannot be delivered without volunteers. I am hugely proud of that statement, and I thank you profoundly on behalf of my entire team, as well as the volunteers, for that statement, because this is something that people carry with them for the rest of their life, and that is what volunteerism is about. Thanks, IFRC, for the partnership also. We are going to be doing great things together. This is an enormous encouragement for me and the team moving forward. I'd like to thank the board members so much. Oh, there's one more speaker. I'm sorry. Let me then stop here.
I thank the UNV executive coordinator, and we didn't mean to interrupt your statement, but we've noticed we have one more request for the floor. Le représentant de la République démocratique du Congo souhaite...
The representative of the Democratic Republic of Congo would like to speak. I give you the floor. Thank you, Madam Chair, for having granted me the floor at the end. Because I hadn't intended to speak, but given the importance of the consideration of this agenda item, my delegation would also like to align itself with all of the delegations which have thanked the administrator for his exhaustive report, and especially the executive director of the United Nations Volunteers Program for his annual report, and for the midterm review of the strategic program of the UNV, which is very important in the context of pursuing the Sustainable Development Goals. This program's work in DRC is involved in peacekeeping. As you all know, my country hosts one of the most major, the most largest programs in MONUSCO, and then in the areas of environment, community development, and capacity development, specifically on the local level. This program is carried out through UNDP services, and as an example, 43 volunteers serve in the aviation section of MONUSCO in the aerial operations of the UN mission in Congo. And so that this can happen in good conditions where communications are very difficult and air travel is very important to transport blue helmets as well as the goods of the UN, which need to be deployed throughout the country. So we in the DRC are truly satisfied with the services provided by the UN Volunteers Program in our country. In addition to their logistical function in MONUSCO, the UN volunteers also play a significant role in strengthening capacity as well as managing air traffic control and other related services. They also provide other activities for training and awareness raising among civil society and local authorities so that they can be more involved in peacekeeping and peace building in a post-conflict country. In conclusion, at a time when United Nations Volunteers programs are trying to expand their strategic scope to include new programs from Agenda 2030, we believe that it is time to recruit more broadly volunteers, because we believe that this UNV program is not significantly well known, especially in developing countries and especially in LDCs. So we support the request of Guinea, who made this proposal to broaden the criteria for involvement in the UN Volunteers Program, because we have many young people who could join this program to contribute to the Sustainable Development Program. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
Je remercie.
I thank the representative of the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and I would like to give the floor once again to Mr. Dikdjous.
I don't want to prolong the session, but I just wanted to recognize two things. One is the fact that Haiti has probably spoken quite eloquent about the involvement and the contribution of volunteers from all over the world in Haiti, but also DRC has talked about the volunteers that have contributed so well to air traffic control and other things. And actually, you're talking about nationals from your own countries. You're talking about that kind of an experience. We see very strongly that national volunteer schemes, engagement of young people in voluntary actions to improve the social well-being of the entire society, is hugely important for long-term resilience and peace. We need to make sure that we find different ways of investing in that, because we have seen where countries have been able to do this, that the returns have been significant. I'm talking about countries like Togo, but I'm also talking about countries like Nigeria and Kenya, where this has been going on and happening for a long period of time. We have enormously good experiences recently in West African region with ECOWAS for regional schemes. And this is something that seems to be building on itself now. And our expectation is that over the next 5 years, with the rollout of the SDGs, you will be seeing more national and regional volunteer schemes strongly promoted and supported by member states, by countries themselves, to bring the young people and to bring the power of volunteerism more into SDG implementation. Thank you.
I thank the UNV Executive Coordinator. And with this statement, we have reached the end of the session of this afternoon. I wish to inform the Board that a draft decision is being prepared on this item, and we will revert to item 9 later to adopt the decision. Before adjourning the afternoon meeting, I wish to remind delegations that from 6 o'clock, there will be informal consultations on draft decisions, and I also have to announce that there is a change of location for the informal on draft decisions that was announced by the President. These informal consultations are now taking place in Conference Room B at 6 p.m., as I said, and not in this room, because we need to leave this room for an evening event. So Conference Room B at 6 p.m. With this afternoon's session is adjourned.